This is a University of Otago podcast.
Hi, I'm Charles Pigden of the Department of Philosophy at the University of Otago. And today I'm in conversation with Professor James R. Flynn, Emeritus Professor of Politics at Otago, famous, among other things, as the discoverer of the Flynn effect, winner of numerous awards for his work both in politics and in psychology, and perhaps the most influential academic currently working at the University of Otago. Jim, you were born in 1934 in America and of Irish-American stock. How much has being an Irish-American affected you?
I think it's affected me in terms of who my parents were, and they were not atypical of Irish-Americans at the time. My father was born in America in southern Missouri. And that gave him a mild racial prejudice against blacks. It's really a semi-southern area. He, of course, hated the English so much there wasn't much energy to hate anyone else. But like all Irish Americans of the day, the premium was to pay off the family mortgage, to own land, which they had not owned in Ireland. And therefore, the boys were all sent out to work between about 11 and 13, including my father. The girls, my grandfather was too proud to put them out to service, so they stayed in school through high school, but the boys did not. He joined a factory, the Rumsey Sycamore Bedspring Factory, which was pretty repetitive work, and it gave him a settled sense of opposition to the rich, the factory owner. In 1900, when William Jennings Bryan ran for president and my father was 15, the boss put up a sign which said, if this county goes for Bryan, there'll be no work for 2 weeks. Since they voted for William Jennings Bryan, they were locked out for 2 weeks. So I think I got from my father this sense of opposition to the moneyed interests of America. So I presume that was to some degree responsible for my liberal bent. He also believed only in the fundamentals of what the church said, which was whatever he found convenient. So while I was raised a Catholic, he at least was not a great pressure for orthodoxy.
Right, so he had like a semi-critical view.
To be a Catholic was a badge of Irish nationalism.
Right.
It was forbidden. And you never questioned that you were a Catholic. But I don't think it really upset him, let's say, that he might not have always made his Easter duty.
Right.
You're supposed to once a year receive communion in certain circumstances to remain a communicant Catholic. So I don't know that the letter of the law meant much to him.
I guess that brings me to your own religious evolution. You rejected religion in your early teens?
Well, before that, I was at least in doubt. When I was a child, I, of course, was bathed in religion. I was an altar boy. So while my father didn't pressure me, and my mother was a Protestant, but my mother admired Catholicism because they always went to church. But I was an altar boy, and I believed completely, and my faith was absolutely stern in terms of the commandments of the church. But fortunately, when I was about 11, two things happened. My family got the Book of Knowledge, and I read that, and I got interested in the nebular hypothesis, and I got interested in evolution, and I decided that I really was a Catholic only because I'd been told to be one. And I also got, in an essay contest, I won the book of an encyclopedia, Funk and Wagnalls, I think it was. And in that, I read about the Socialist Party. And it seemed to have a lot of resonance with this notion that there should be a better break for the poor in America. After all, I was born during the Great Depression in 1934, and my father was out of work. And he was struggling. We never went hungry. But he had only piecework on the copy desk of a newspaper. He was a self-trained journalist. And this, I think, was important. Now, the other thing that was important about my father was that although he was self-educated, he was very widely read.
Right.
He probably had a larger vocabulary than I do, and he used to do the New York Times crossword puzzle in ink. That was to show that he never made mistakes. And he read me all of Dickens when I was about four. So by the time I was about six, I was reading not so much children's books, but things like Treasure Island and A Tree Grows in Brooklyn, that is semi-adult books.
Right.
So I was used to reading, and the reading the encyclopedias was fairly natural. Now, by the age of 11 then, I had developed doubts. I wasn't confirmly convinced the church was wrong, but I was doubtful. And when Father Burns, at the age of 12, said, "Would you like to go to St. Charles," which was a school for high school boys who wanted to become priests, I said, "No, I want to think about things." And that was important because, of course, you could leave St. Charles, but you had to have the effrontery to tell the priests that you no longer believed what they did. And that, of course, took a considerable amount of courage. I don't think I'd have ever become a priest, but it would have made for a humiliating set of circumstances.
And a much more stormy adolescence than you actually had.
I presume so. I don't think the family wanted me to be a priest particularly, but they would...
It was just something that it was natural for bright boys from a Catholic background to do.
To be at least asked to do. And as I say, I was resistant, fortunately for me. And by the time I was 14 or 15, I was a confirmed atheist and a member of the Socialist Party.
I guess there's a question that occurs to me. I'll compare it with somebody else who we both admire. Bertrand Russell said during the World War I, when he was opposing the war, that he felt as if he had heard the voice of God. Now, of course, by this time, he too was an atheist. He didn't believe in God. But his sense of commitment, had he thought a semi-religious inspiration, probably wouldn't felt quite the same way about things had he not had a religious upbringing. Now, you know, you strike people as a fairly sort of driven, committed person, I think. Do you think that your religious upbringing has anything to do with this?
It posed the chief problem that drove me through my academic career, and that is once I lost my faith that religion told you what was right or wrong, I became obsessed with the notion as to whether you could build a rational or evidential foundation for humane ideals. And of course, that problem really was the chief problem that I addressed up until I published in 2000, How to Defend Humane Ideals. So certainly it focused me on moral questions and how to justify. And during the years when I couldn't see any way to defend humane ideals, I got involved at the university with the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, working to try and get better housing for students in the university neighborhood on the theory that if anything was right or wrong, certainly racial bias was wrong.
Right.
That it was a paradigm example. And throughout my life, once I became grounded in my own beliefs and ethics, I've always thought that it was wrong or silly to just talk about ethics rather than practicing it.
Right.
So I've never sought out crusades, but when I've been in circumstances where morality seemed to impose political activity, I've always been involved in them.
Right.
In America, for example, I was not only active on the race issue in the North, but when I first taught in the South, I was chairman of CORE in Central Kentucky and was bounced from my first academic post.
Yes, I was reading about that. It's in your first book, and what strikes me about the pressure that was put on you was how the various authority figures, including the president of the University of Eastern Kentucky, was it?
Yes.
Were how petty and mean and cowardly the kinds of pressure they imposed were.
He was a career politician. He had been a highway commissioner and was suspected of financial irregularity. I don't know if it was ever proved. But he donated very lavishly to the governor's campaign fund, and this raised questions as to where the money came from. But he became president of the university really thinking of himself as paving the way, I think, for his own
bid for governor.
Yeah. And therefore, he saw the work I did. Eastern Kentucky was a very southern town, Richmond was. The state changes as you go down the highway. I mean, just south of Richmond, Kentucky was Berea, which was founded by abolitionists. But Richmond, Kentucky was a farmer slave-owning center. The police roughed up blacks on the weekends for amusement. The schools were segregated. You have to remember that was not unusual. In Washington, D.C., when I was raised, the schools were segregated. Washington, D.C. was quite a southern town until the post-war. And eastern Kentucky, you still had segregation. Blacks couldn't go to the public parks. And it just seemed to me that this was a situation, once the sit-in movement had started, that you could not ignore.
Right.
And when I became active, I was relieved as coach of the cross-country team. Presidential monitors were paid $5 a week to report on conversations. Eventually, my phones were tapped and my telegrams intercepted, but I'm not so sure that that was the local president. I don't know that he had the clout.
That could have been the FBI.
Well, it was because Lyndon Johnson was coming to give a convocation address. And he at that time was vice president and was charge of the Equal Opportunities Employment Commission. And of course, I sent him a telegram saying that in point of fact, given that he had this role, he was coming to a community where only the federal ordinance hired blacks, where there was no equal employment, and I would like to see him. And I think that panicked the president. He intercepted that telegram. And he thought, who knows what's going to happen? He might attack the president, or he might do the vice president. He might do almost anything. So I was arrested while trying to leave town. Actually, my successors in Corps were going to interview him. I wasn't. And I was held at the police station incommunicado until he left town. But some of it was fairly petty. I mean, the presidential monitors and not being coach of the cross-country team, but you felt a real sense of threat. I mean, I was roughed up on the street in one of our demonstrations. I didn't feel I had normal police protection.
Yeah, I suppose the thing that occurred to me about it was that the NAACP had a non-violent ideology.
And this was CORE, actually.
Yeah, in CORE, right, so yeah. CORE. But it had the same non-violent ideology, and that was partly inspired by sort of Gandhian themes, I guess, originally.
And King, of course,
yeah.
Martin Luther
King. Who was, of course, a big admirer of Gandhi. But the idea there is that you're supposed to act in such a way as to always see the human being, your opponent, and you fundamentally believe in human brotherhood. And the idea is that you bring out the human being, your opponent, by the way you act. I must say, it struck me as very hard to do it with some of these guys.
Many in our group looked upon nonviolence as a tactic.
Right.
That is, you couldn't afford, given what America was like, to have pictures of blacks using violence against whites.
Right.
All the pictures had to be in the other direction. So you were trained that if you went to sit in at a drug counter and some guy came up behind you and put cigarettes out on the back of your neck or picked up a little black girl and threw her through a window, that all the pictures had to be of that. They could not be pictures of you retaliating. So many of the people accepted nonviolence, not as King did, as a matter of Christian principle, but tactically. Now, of course, I wasn't a Christian.
No.
But I had a certain sympathy for some of these people. For example, the police chief in town, who certainly didn't give blacks a fairer go, and I know that he knew some of his officers roughed them up on weekends. He had a black mistress whom he didn't acknowledge. He was a guy who never had finished grade school and was really a dispossessed person. His only prestige came from being a police chief, and he had a certain presence, a certain oratory. So I certainly was never cheated of the ability to see the other side as human beings. But I think that fundamentally nonviolence was a tactic.
Right. Right. Rather than
an abstract principle.
Right. Right. Yeah, it was just something that struck me when I was, reading your
sure.
account in the book. I thought, these people are so yeah. They just struck me as the tactics were kind of cowardly and contemptible.
They were the traditional Southern tactics of intimidation. Mm. And since the Democratic Party needed Southern votes in the Senate and the House, that the government under Jack Kennedy was non-interventionist. He had to be bullied every step of the way by King, fearing that King would be killed, to take many of the steps he did. I mean, he was always terrified that on his watch King would be assassinated. And therefore he grudgingly took steps, despite the fact that that upset Southern senators in the Democratic Party, to do something on civil rights.
Right.
If a federal highway in the South was interfered with, you had federal marshals down there, you know, opening it. If blacks on the steps of a federal courthouse were beaten up trying to register to vote, somehow the powers of the federal government were too limited.
Right.
To ever intervene. So you had to take nonviolent personal action, and I considered that an imperative. I hadn't gone there looking for it.
Right, right. Jumping back a bit, because we're now talking about your very early academic career.
Yeah.
How was your time at the University of Chicago? Who was there who influenced you or whose work interested you?
I'd gone there originally with the notion of doing pure maths or theoretical physics. My brother had advised me that Chicago was the best in the world for this. And I got a scholarship, and I went there. But very quickly I decided that being a pure mathematician was too much like being a chess grandmaster. It was too remote from human beings. This is ironic because my son is a pure mathematician.
I was just going to say.
And I can understand the pleasure he takes in it. But very quickly I decided that I wanted to do either politics or philosophy.
Right.
And from my background, I thought more in terms of applied ethics, political activism. But also, because of my Catholic background, I was desperate to find some sort of justification for humane ideals. Now, I didn't know it, but at the time, Leo Strauss was there. And he was someone who took very seriously the problem of ethical skepticism. He never, however, really revealed his solution. That is, he talked vaguely that Aristotle was correct and that Plato and Aristotle were essentially proof against skepticism. But you never had trotted out the justification. And in later years, I became convinced that he secretly had no justification, but thought it was best to conceal this fact. Now, that may, of course, have done him a disservice, but it was a mystery thing. If you were on the inner circle, you listened to various hints. And these hints somehow gave you a notion of how you could defend humane ideals, but these were never to be made explicit, even to his general run of students. So I had a lot of ambivalence about that.
Yeah, it reminds me actually of, Kantians sometimes suggest that they've got, an argument giving a defense of the objectivity of morals, or at least the intersubjectivity of morals. And you think, well, if you have an argument, let's actually see it, Could you, lay it out on a couple of pages so that we can have a look at it? Instead, it's always surrounded with a sort of huge cloud of words.
You may be familiar with Bloom's book on higher education in America. It created a great story.
Yeah, I've heard of it. I think I actually looked at it a bit. But
yes,
yeah.
And in it, there's the same game. Today people don't teach Aristotle as if he were true. And there's a great business about how wicked ethical skepticism is. And the whole implication is that if you only studied Aristotle with sufficient depth, you would be immune against this, but no analysis is ever put forward. It's the same game. Ethical skepticism is wicked. We know it's wicked. There's an answer somewhere in the ancients, but of course I'm not about to reveal it, though that's never said. It's just never done.
Right.
He was a Straussite, of course.
Yes.
And they went all over the world, and sometimes they did a lot of good in arguing with postmodernists, and that they certainly believed in objectivity. But all over the world, there was this esoteric sort of faith that we know the truth and value-free social science is all wrong, but somehow the truth was never made manifest to the public.
Can I... we might continue on this in a bit, but I want to talk about why did you leave the United States and come to New Zealand?
Well, after I left the South, I became deeply disturbed by the arms race. You have to remember this was the time when Jack Kennedy was advising everyone to build fallout shelters. And you were told if you couldn't stock enough food, you could have tinned animal food because it would sustain you. And the Brookfields Zoo, the Lion House was declared a fallout shelter. And you wondered if you were supposed to eat the lions or they were going to eat you. And it seemed to me that this, again, was an imperative. And I was active in the Committee of 1,000 to elect peace candidates and was also active in the Socialist Party. And I had no trouble at Wisconsin State because socialists had been mayors of Milwaukee, and that didn't frighten them. But somehow, when I went to Lake Forest College near Chicago, I gave a talk entitled A Socialist Approach to America. It was really just about socialized medicine. And I was bounced there. Now, the ostensible reasons were, oddly, that I had not published enough, though I said, well, I have a book that's under scrutiny, and that didn't seem to count. I said, what if that comes through? And the other thing was that in teaching the American government course, rather than just assigning the head's text, I'd given collateral readings, which he had never wanted to forbid, but was confusing to the students. It would have been wrong to have forbidden me to do it, but not wrong to fire me for having done it. And so there was this academic facade, but it was quite clear that the real reason was that I was politically incorrect. He remarked, for example, how many socialists were there? And I said, well, probably only about half of 1% of a population. He said, well, then they're overrepresented. And I said, yes, you'd have to have a department of 200 before you could even have one socialist. Otherwise, we'd be overrepresented. And why didn't he just satisfy for the fact that I taught political science in a non-ideological way? But the conversation went nowhere, and I was bounced. And this was the second time. And I was getting tired of going to universities where I was the low person on the totem pole and had to work up all the new courses and had no time to publish. And I interviewed at a few places where I was turned down on my politics. In one of the Florida universities, they didn't like the fact that I had been an activist. I learned this from a member of the department. And out on the West Coast, I was turned down by a former general who saw I was in committee for a sane nuclear policy. So it seemed to make sense to kill three birds with one stone, that is, to go somewhere I wasn't always getting fired. Secondly, my wife's parents had been close to the Communist Party, and they had been persecuted during the Cold War, so she wasn't adverse. And then finally, I had a better image of New Zealand than elsewhere. I certainly didn't want to go to South Africa, but I knew something of the White Australian policy. So New Zealand seemed attractive.
Right.
And originally, it was not a matter of burning your bridges, but it was not a matter of necessarily coming back. It was a matter of seeing what it was like. And of course, John Pocock was a very distinguished scholar. He was the one I went to work under in Christchurch. So there were academic attractions, there was getting out from under being fired all the time, and there was getting away from the Cold War atmosphere of America. That was very important.
This is something that's occurred to me in a slightly different context, but did you want to live in a place where you didn't have to feel indignant the whole time?
Well, I didn't initially feel indignant, and I wasn't much active in politics.
Well, I meant that
yes,
was the attraction
right.
of
You're
coming.
Quite right. I joined the Labour Party, and I did canvass for them. But the next time I really felt an imperative, and also remember, you're at a bit of a handicap for being a foreigner, particularly one with an American accent. There's a feeling, what are you doing meddling in our affairs? So the next time I really felt I had to get politically active was when there was the potential for the New Zealand nuclear free.
Right.
Oh, no, the first was Vietnam. I wanted the New Zealand troops out of Vietnam, and I think I had at least some influence in talking to Norman Kirk on that issue. But I also wanted the country nuclear free. I didn't want New Zealand to be unfriendly to America, but I didn't want her to encourage America to just pile up weapons willy-nilly without any sense or point. So I was active on those grounds. And during my, I guess, the 60s in New Zealand, when did the nuclear free policy come in? Was under Longy.
Yes, so about 1980.
I think it was about earlier than that, a little earlier. But at any rate, that was my main area. But it wasn't intense. It was mainly just going around giving lectures.
Right. Applying for the Chair of Politics at Otago?
Well, I was a lecturer at Canterbury, and I had been promoted the year before I left to senior lecturer. I was 4 years there. But I, of course, had this apprehension from my past of not wanting to work under a department head who might have political bias. Now, that certainly wasn't true with John Pocock, but who knows? He left the following year. And I doubt anyone would have come in that would have found my politics a burden, but I did want to be head of a department. That is, I did want to be the person who did help do the hiring and firing, so I wouldn't be under the gun. So it was very attractive to come down to Otago, and I got the foundation chair there in 67.
That just this is a very small thing, but it's political studies at Otago, not political science, and that's your...
Want to get involved in the silly argument about whether politics was a science. To call it Department of Politics seemed to me a bit too political, though that's what it's called now, I think. And political science was too much all this nonsense about whether social science was truly a science. And moreover, my main area was moral and political philosophy. And political studies made it clear that we were interested in all problems that had to do with politics, not just research into political behavior. So we did choose that. Auckland went the same direction.
I think it's a good direction to go, precisely for that reason.
And Canterbury was political science.
It just sounds a little pretentious.
And I think Waikato became politics. But since then, since I retired as chair, they've made it the Department of Politics.
Well, it's okay, too.
Don't have any objection to that.
The political science one does seem to me questionable.
It's a science in the sense that it tries to analyze and predict human behavior. It's not a science in the sense that attempts to quantify it in the way of the natural sciences work.
Or delivering robust...
Yeah, so, things like equilibrium theory and game theory, these are of tangential importance, but...
Tools, but no more.
Yeah.
Now, maybe we could talk a bit more about a thing that we've already addressed to some extent, which is your work on, justifying humane ideals.
Yes, and that was my passion.
You brought out American politics, which is very political in a way. It's about your take on American politics in the 60s, with some interesting reminiscences. But your next book after that was Humanism and Ideology, which was an attempt to justify humane ideals. And then later on, there's How to Justify Humane Ideals Itself.
In the year 2000.
Yeah.
That's after several books on IQ. Of
yeah,
course.
We'll come back to them in sequence, I think. So I'd like to get that part sort of sorted. And you think that humanism and ideology, which was your first attempt to solve the problem, was in the end a failure?
Oh, no. Oh, it was a failure in the sense that it sold about 1,000 copies.
Right. I don't mean.
But
it wasn't
an enormously influential. I had always had a sense of standing apart from the philosophical community. It wasn't that I was a Straussite, but I actually found much more stimulating material to read in Plato and Kant and Aristotle. I didn't think any of them had solved the problem, but they'd at least tried to solve the problem. I was most important. And I felt that almost all modern philosophy had either given up or was practicing certain evasions, that is, pseudo-arguments that made no sense to me at all. So I'm afraid I was a fairly lonely figure. I published American Politics because as a rye from America, you were in vogue to give lectures on American politics, and I needed that to get a chair. But I was obsessed with that problem. I became convinced in the first book, Humanism and Ideology, that the sort of modern Aristotelianism that I had developed was not adequate. I could understand Aristotle thinking that there was a perfection to human nature, and this was known by eudaimonia, or a sense that psychic well-being was natural to human beings. But there seemed no reason why someone should become a virtuoso of a sense of well-being. That is, you could easily argue that the tortured artist is the highest ethical ideal. So I then had to recalibrate my thoughts on the subject. And doing the books on race and IQ were very interesting because they showed me that you could find arguments against racism that had nothing to do with not being an ethical skeptic. You know, even if you thought all of your moral ideas were based on your psychology and that commitment to humane ideals was the only firm foundation, you could still take on someone who is committed to racist ideals and show them that when they turn to the real world, these value proclivities meant that you had to have bridging propositions that were false. I mean, you might hate black people, but you didn't run down the streets just saying, I hate the color black, any more than Marx ran down the street saying, I love workers. If you wanted to turn racism into a political ideology, you had to prove blacks were inferior. And of course, I became convinced that you couldn't do it. And I was certainly completely convinced you couldn't do it to the point that the racists needed. So I began to develop a whole new approach. I said, well, the skeptic is half right. We do base our moral ideals on our psychology and our sense of humane commitment. There are a lot of other people around who are not committed in that same way. But even Nietzsche accepts an agenda for moral debate. I mean, he wants to show that what he says is logically consistent. He wants to show that his values are in contact with what the real world really is rather than an illusory world. And you can approach these anti-humane ideologues and show either that they are logically incoherent, that they fly in the face of what science tells us about human beings or the real world, and you can use tools of this sort to show, arguing over this agenda. Nietzsche believed in justice. He believed in justice among supermen. He just didn't think herd men were worthy of it, and he thought it was ignoble to give it to them. So you have to take a new approach, and that's what I eventually developed in my book, How to Defend Humane Ideals. I consider it the most important book I wrote. The next most important would be my little book, Fate and Philosophy, which gives my views on other questions. But I don't hold a chair of philosophy. I only published intermittently in the philosophy journals. I published in the American Philosophical Quarterly and the Scottish one and a few journals of that sort, but only half a dozen articles. So the book was generally treated, as Jeremy Waldron, who plugged it, said, as from out of left field. People didn't like half solutions. And most people just, I think, because they half knew they didn't know how to deal with him, hadn't faced up to people like Nietzsche. And so this book, which took a logical and empirical approach based on philosophical analysis and said we're only half right, didn't seem to have much appeal.
Right. So the extent to which the person who is not humane is unrefuted is, if they are sufficiently prepared to hang on to ideals which seem arbitrary or which are clearly non-universal, you know, you can't, I just like people like this, I just value these people rather than those people, but with no sort of systematic justification of that in terms of qualities other people might respect, then they can be logically impregnable. And that's the sense in which you know, there isn't any objectivity. To such a person, you can't show them things which will convince them that they're wrong. It's if they are playing a certain kind of moral game, if they're in principle saying, well, you know, I only want to discriminate between different groups of people if there's a really serious difference, and I think there is a serious difference, blah, blah, blah. If they're accepting those kinds of principles, then you can use empirical science, logic, etc., to push them in a humane direction. That's the basis of it.
You can push them away from their ideology, but you can never make them love humanity.
Right.
That cannot come from philosophy. It comes from within. You can show Nietzsche that if he wants to maximize creative genius, the caste society ruled by the military that he suggests is about the worst society imaginable to maximize creative genius. And he can, and he also, of course, was against teaching the masses literacy because then they demand political power. And if we write off all the people that became creative geniuses because of the spread of literacy, we've written off the lot. So I can show Nietzsche that he can't turn his moral proclivities into a coherent political ideology. I cannot make him conquer his distaste for the average person.
Right.
And if he wants to spit on them insofar as they can't retaliate, he can. Further, he can advise someone who is sure of their artistic greatness, who runs out of money, that it's all right to murder someone in an alley to get it. So to that degree, I can't win him over. I cannot make him humane, and I cannot forbid him to practice the private ethics he might want. I can, however, keep him from being an ideological competitor for the allegiance of humankind. And this is the position I'm afraid I'm in.
Right.
And that doesn't give the philosophers who want to believe in objectivity all they want. And my approach to them, for one thing, they're not educated enough to pursue it, most of them. You know, they don't know a lot of social science and they don't know human genetics. So it's much more satisfying to try and find a philosophical justification. You'll note that if you read the index of their books, their Nietzsche is almost never mentioned. And if he is mentioned, it's in some silly footnote which says Nietzsche was crazy and of course rational people can't convince crazy people. And it's swept under the carpet. So I didn't expect the book to rage through the philosophical world. I thought it might attract more attention than it has because so many of the positions taken in current philosophy are so completely threadbare. I thought people might be bored with them by now and interested in something new.
Now, if you really want to... Now, there are some people who really will say anything to defend, you know, the objectivity.
Oh, they blind
value.
Themselves in a whole range of ways.
Yeah.
They talk about human flourishing and... They talk about a moral reality and, you know, it's pathetic, really.
So, we've got that, I think, you know, a clear view of what that agenda is. So going back now to your work on IQ and particularly race and IQ, it seems to me that this falls into three phases. The first phase is when is your first book on the subject, Race, IQ, and Jensen, in which you are resisting the way that Jensen was using a bunch of supposed facts and some genuine facts to justify what some people might think of as a racist approach to education.
I want to make clear that Jensen was never a racist in the sense that he disliked blacks.
No, no.
If his daughter had come home with a black boyfriend, I don't think he would have turned a hair.
Yeah.
And he always said that people should be judged on their merits. So what difference did it make if blacks, on average, had worse genes for intelligence than whites? He conceded that the brightest person in America might be a black male because the two curves overlapped.
Yes.
This shows, of course, his political and moral naivete, because if blacks are, on average, notably less intelligent than whites because of their genes, it, of course, fortifies a regime like South Africa, which says if they're occasionally brilliant blacks, yes, but if we give them the vote and they run our society, they couldn't run a modern industrial society. It gives sustenance to people who want to bar black migration. It certainly means that they can say, well, we'll only let in the doctors and lawyers. The rest are on average too stupid to make their way and will end up as welfare bums. So that book was supposed to be just about 5 or 6 pages in how to defend humane ideals. That is, I thought that I would find that social scientists overwhelmingly were on the side of racial equality. And it stunned me to find a man as well educated and as broadly educated and as rational as Jensen, who claimed that the evidence showed that blacks really were inferior on average. So I ended up writing a whole book on the subject. Now, that book has been influential. It's a sort of minor classic. And it's the first book that tried to argue with Jensen evidentially, rather than just beating up his kids or threatening him or trying to destroy him.
So what's the key argument where you're challenging his view as to the facts? I mean, there are two kinds of argument you could have in this connection. You could say, well, supposing you're right, still the moral and political consequences don't follow. But the other thing you could say is, look, I think that you're wrong because, as to the sort of facts. So what in that book are the key arguments?
Well, Jensen's arguments rested mainly on performing an intellectual experiment, which said, let us imagine doing away with certain inequalities between black and white. Would that eliminate the IQ gap? For example, there are about 1 standard deviation below whites for socioeconomic status. And he said, okay, let's pick blacks who are 1 standard deviation of socioeconomic status above other blacks. How do their IQs compare? Well, they still compare rather badly. And I argued that it was much better to find points in history where blacks had actually exchanged environments with whites. And while these were few, and the number of subjects were not numerous, that this took priority. And of course, I did an immense amount of study around I first study in Germany, where it turned out that the children of black servicemen who are illegitimate had the same IQ as the children of white servicemen. And later on, I developed that much more thoroughly in my subsequent books on the race issue, because I found a number of other things that these black children in Germany, ignoring the fact that they equaled whites for IQ, if you looked at all of the different aspects of IQ, such as analytic ability, vocabulary, manipulating objects in space, in America, the blacks tend to fall behind whites as these tasks become more complex. And you, therefore, are driven in a position. Either their genes means they can't handle complex problems, or environment is here somewhere. And when I later analyzed the black children in Germany, their difference with whites on subtests had nothing to do with cognitive complexity. That is, the black-white eye gap was not a function of whether problems became more complicated or not.
So this is obviously a fairly small sample. That you're comparing white children of American servicemen and black children of American servicemen in Germany.
In Germany.
Of which presumably there are a sufficiently large sample size.
There were a large number, but not a large number were studied. Right. You know, giving these tests is a hell of a job.
Right.
So there are about, maybe 70 blacks and 140 whites. Now, I also read Elsie Moore later on. And she, during the 80s, had conducted a study where black children were adopted out by either white professional parents or black professional. The black and white mothers both had 16 years of education. The fathers were in professions or sub-professions. And all black infants were adopted out, so it didn't look like a difference was going to be genetic. And the black kids raised by white parents at the age of 8.5 were 13 points above those raised by black professional parents. Well, this convinced me that there was something about black subculture that did not challenge blacks intellectually to the same degree as whites. That meant, of course, I was vilified. If you said the difference was genetic, they wanted to string you up. If you said that black subculture did not bring blacks to their full mental maturity, you were then blaming the victim. But of course, if you don't investigate problems, you can't solve them. When Elsie Moore called these mothers in to work on problems with their children, the white mothers with 16 years of education were universally positive. This looks interesting. Why don't we try that? The black mothers with 16 years of education were universally censorious. You aren't that stupid. You know better than that. So I began the only answer you can really give to Jensen on the race issue, and that is to look at blacks from the time a mother becomes pregnant until blacks become mature, and see if you can find strands in their subculture that means that it is less oriented towards cognitive achievement. And this is what I finally did in my book, Where Have All the Liberals Gone?
Right.
There are three chapters in there on blacks, and one of them very carefully analyzes blacks from conception to maturity and points out that the environments that they're in as part of black subculture do not have the same emphasis on cognitive development.
We'll come back to Where Have All the Liberals Gone, but I first want to look at the other two phases in the IQ thing, which are as I said, there's the discovery of the Flynn effect, and then there's explaining the Flynn effect, which is the last couple of books. So the Flynn effect is basically that all over the world, people's IQ scores have been going up for a long time, for about 100 years.
At least that. We have birth date data that goes back to 1872 in Britain. But that, you might wonder, how can we tell before IQ tests were invented? But of course, people who had been born in 1872, when they were adults, took these tests.
Right.
And we can plot birthdays and show the earlier your birthday, the worse your IQ was. So it's been going on in Britain since the Industrial Revolution.
And it's,
it's all over the place.
All over the place, all different nations. And the gains are really spectacular between generations.
I had an advantage here because as a moral philosopher, I was an outsider and didn't know what had to be true. And that made me more amenable to seeing in the literature that these tremendous gains were hidden there. They were hidden there, but they were largely unrecognized.
And the reason that they were hidden was that people keep renorming
the tests.
So you design the test so that the average score is 100.
Always 100. But you see,
and you keep doing that generation by generation, but that masks the fact that people are doing better and better and better on the tests.
And the way around that was Raven's progressive matrices has never given IQs. Raven's always just took the number of answers right out of 60. And John Raven was quite unaware that the scores had improved a lot. And since he never renormed or offered IQs, he was open to the notion, though, of looking at the raw scores. And you found that over the century, out of 60 questions, the number of people who got, let's say, 30 or 40 or 50 right had gone up astronomically. So that was one way of breaking out of that bind.
And I remember one thing you said to me about this. Somebody who scored at the average level for an American of about 100 years ago, who scored at that level on an IQ test nowadays, would be incapable of following a moderately complicated ball game like gridiron. Well, and we know that the average American of 100 years ago was capable of following
gridiron. Of course they were. So it created a great crisis in the area of intelligence, which I tried to solve in my book, What is Intelligence? And the crisis was, the scores seemed to show that our ancestors were very stupid, and more are that we were geniuses, and both of these seemed to be false. And then they found that the IQ gains over time weren't in the right pattern.
Before we get to that, I just want to say the effect of this with respect to the racial issue is, somebody like Jensen would argue, look, there are these big differences between different racial groups.
That's right.
The obvious explanation is a genetic one. And you can say, well, there are even bigger differences between different generations of the same group.
Yes, but they're purely environmental.
And since they're the same group, this can't be a genetic difference, so it must be environmental. And this, then that, of course, doesn't show that all differences between groups are environmental, but it does put the person who's a defender of genetic differences really on the back foot.
Yes, it means that Jensen's view that environmental variables were too feeble to produce grains over time was falsified. It was clear that they were easily potent enough. Now, of course, you can't just blandly assume that what separates black and white is what separates people today from people in 1950. You have to give an explanation specific to the case. But it certainly did blow that wide open. But it also, as I say, posed great problems for the theory of intelligence.
Yes.
Our ancestors were not feeble-minded. There is a big difference. Today we have in America about 17 years of schooling, and they had about six. Now, there's a big difference between people in 1900 who didn't have the advantage of modern education and thought processes, and people today who are exposed to those advantages and can't make use of them. I mean, they're the genuinely mentally retarded. Superficially, on an IQ test, the people in 1900 will look like they are mentally retarded, but of course they weren't. And it also falsified all sorts of pessimism about genes. My most recent book, Intelligence and Human Progress, points out that virtually everyone after Darwin was convinced that the genes of the masses meant that they could never play significant social roles. Well, we've gone from a society in which 3% were professionals and subprofessionals to 35%. So they were wrong. I mean, their genetic pessimism was wrong. And they were genetically pessimistic that people could ever be pacified. This was supposed to be an offshoot of Darwin, but it was really just the London mob. They, you know, they were scared of the streets.
So they felt there couldn't be a society in which, like, most people are law-abiding citizens.
Exactly.
And not violent.
And that's been proved wrong,
unless
too.
It was sort of viciously enforced by
exactly.
A sort of oppressive police state.
Well, the only one person in 100,000 who die in Europe today is by violence. During Elizabethan times, it was 15. So it was possible for human beings, through environmental change, to both take the commanding roles of society. I proved through vocabulary tests that the average person with an average education today probably has the range of vocabulary that a professional did in 1900. And they also have become much less violent. Now, they've been tamed to some degree like animals. You tame a dog not to attack its master, but the rules allow it to attack people outside. So a lot more of the taming applied to domestic society than international society. We became much tamer in terms of killing people within communities, but we're capable of being stirred to be homicidal lunatics outside the communities. Now, the less aggressive genes would have had some carryover, of course, but the battle to make us less aggressive on the international scene is still going on.
And this relates to, you know, somebody who's produced a very interesting and significant work recently and who is a big admirer of yours, namely Steven Pinker. He's got this book, The Better Angels of Our Nature.
Very good book.
And he argues that though there have been sort of very significant blips, there is a gradual decline in violence, both interpersonal violence within societies and international violence over the past few hundred years. And that, but he also wants to suggest that this, at least in more recent times, because he's got a big historical focus,
that's
he
right.
goes back hundreds of years, but in more recent times, he wants to suggest that the cognitive skills cultivated by a modern society,
yep.
which lead to, in your view, the big IQ gains we've seen, are connected with
yes.
the decrease
well,
in violence.
Yes, well, I'm in touch with Pinker, and he and I are... He was one of the few who picked that out of my work for emphasis. But I've since elaborated it further. We today generalize, we take the hypothetical seriously, we use logic on hypothetical events. And we tend to do that with our moral inheritance. People in 1900, their moral inheritance was like inheriting the family jewels. It was a thing that you didn't alter. When Martin Luther King marched, my brother and I used to argue with my father, who was born in 1885. And we said, well, what if you woke up black? And he said, that's the dumbest thing you've ever said. Who do you know who has ever woken up black? That is, he was unwilling to take the hypothetical seriously. And he was unwilling to state his prejudices as generalization subject to logic. What really happened in the 20th century is not just that we developed a modern mind to make us more adept at science and education and the professions. We developed a new notation in ethics. You know, in mathematics, notation is awfully important if you've ever tried to multiply Roman numerals.
Yes.
And in ethics, in the 20th century, more and more people began to rebel against nationalism and racism because they are so susceptible to hypothetical arguments. You know, what if you were born black? What if you had a Taliban person down the road and they killed you with a drone? What if you were in Iraq? We've killed 100,000 people there because we didn't like 3,000 Americans being killed. Should they now kill about 3 million of us? These arguments that depend on generalizing your ideals and testing them against the hypothetical and logic have had an enormous amount to do, in my opinion, in the 20th century in advanced countries in making us more pacific. So I think the cognitive progress of the 20th century has been important there. Now, let me say one thing, because I know we're getting, we have to move on. I have been very much interested in people self-educating. And I think one of the tragedies of my university career is how few people get out of university with the ability to use analysis on their moral systems, who get out of university reading widely enough that they know enough about Iraq as to know why it was folly to go in there. And finally, they don't have the tools to make sense of the media. So I have published, of course, a series of three books, The Torchlight List, to encourage you to read widely and actually know about the modern world before you send troops in there to meddle with it. I've published Fate and Philosophy, which is how you can use logic and evidence to scrutinize your own moral beliefs and your beliefs in God. And of course, I've published a little book to give you the tools so that you won't be baffled if anyone gives you a little bit of economic analysis. And it's a great tragedy to me that we don't, in every university, have students who have at least some of this. Now, of course, the PPE degree is a step in the right direction, but not many people take it. Then they learn some politics and history and philosophy and economics.
I should maybe tell you viewers that we do have a PPE program at Otago, and I'm in fact the director of it. But it's actually quite good. We have 83 people doing the major.
That's right.
Which is as many as philosophy.
That's a wonderful thing. But what do we graduate every year?
Less than a third, because they tend to do it in...
I mean, how many people graduate from the university?
Huge number.
That's right.
Yes.
So it's less than 1%,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes, yes.
And I believe, along with Steven Pinker, that in their final year, no matter what their major might be, they should be encouraged to, during their career, read widely in literature. But in their final year, they should be taught something about how philosophy can refine their ideals into something coherent and allow them to know themselves, and they should also be taught elementary economic analysis, what a good social science survey looks like, flaws in moral argument, so when they go out in the world, they can actually deal with the modern world. I mean, just to know conveyancing means you're no more liberated than a medieval serf. I mean, you can't actually do anything to master the modern world, you're just propagandized by it.
So, in effect, these sort of little books on self-education
are very important, are
designed to
communicate my life's history.
But I was going to say, in a way, accentuate these progressive tendencies. There are these things in the broad culture,
yep,
which help us to become, in certain ways, more cognitively skilled, more rational, and more humane. But, you know, you get them kind of patchily and intermittently.
That's right. And you forget about them.
And you forget about them. And this is an attempt to sort of condense them into, you know, certain
and
books
to remind
you, can read,
you what works.
Certain things, so that anybody who thinks they might be, as it were,
well-educated.
Well, who wants to be well-educated and who wants to enhance their cognitive skills in the kind of way which your general argument says benefits society as a whole, can do it for themselves.
And they can benefit themselves by, for the first time, having a rationally coherent view of the world and their own moral and religious commitments. Chekhov once said, man is what he thinks. And if your thoughts are unsystematic, you're a human being who doesn't really know your own potential.
Right. Now, I mean, I think, you know, we could, I guess, I will ask you one slightly challenging question about the Torchlight list. I didn't think there was enough science fiction on it.
Yes, you have to, if you're to limit yourself to 120 novels to cover the world. There are a few things in it about scientists and science. There are a few biographies and histories. I was tempted to put something in it from science fiction because that's an interest of my own. But I know mainly American science fiction, and I couldn't have the whole list of 120 novels American novels. And by the time you've got novels on the race issue, novels on American imperialism, novels on minorities in America, and novels that are wonderful to read just because they're aesthetically pleasing, you pretty much run out.
Yeah, I guess what I would say about that one was that I often find these things too painful to approach if I just read a novel which is about somebody's experience, a fictionalized version of things that really happen. I just find it too painful to read about, and I find it easier to approach if it's, as it were, translated into science fiction medium. I find it
You've
just
read
more
Clifford
pleasurable.
Simak, haven't you?
I've read quite a lot of Clifford Simak.
Yes, well, he has a short story where people keep being sent to Jupiter, and they are changed biologically so they can survive, and no one ever comes back. And the reason is that when you're changed biologically in this way, when you get to Jupiter, you're bathed in things that make you ecstatically happy. And this is a good reason to think about Aristotle's justification of humane ideals. You know, you can be filled with eudaimonia and just sitting on Jupiter and being bathed with ecstatic happiness. So science fiction can be very serious literature.
And I suppose the other thing I thought about was, actually, things that cause me to reflect upon life, you know, in the sort of way where you think the literature can do. Well, it's not just reading; it's movies. It can be television. It can
In the Torchlight list, there are about 40 histories, and the other 40 are films, poems, plays. I mean, some of these are things that really educate you about the modern world. I mean, some of them are very moving. And, of course, many novels have been turned into plays and into films. But I think as I approach my 80th birthday, I certainly intend to go on writing things that will help educate the public. I want to publish something on the climate issue. I finished that, and I want to write something about the periodic banking crises. That is why the world doesn't really have to, every 10 years, be plunged into an agony of despair. So I have things still left, but the things I've really done have been ethics and ethics applied to American foreign policy, written on the race issue, and of course on the theory of intelligence. And then finally, to help people educate themselves.
We've still got, I think, enough time to discuss a couple of your more recent things. I want to just go back to what is my favourite chapter in Where Have All the Liberals Gone? Now, the general theme of Where Have All the Liberals Gone is that, from a socialist, of course, socialist perspective, you have never had a particularly high idea of what you might think of as New Deal politics in the US.
Better than nothing, but
it's, yeah, but yeah. What's happened in the last 30 years is all the advances of the New Deal have been thrown away, or at least most of them. And that what we see is a much more unequal and much more plutocratic society than used to exist. And there are various famous people who, you know, make this point. Sometimes they're just basically new dealers, like Paul Krugman, the economist, and New York Times columnist. But you're, as it were, lamenting this development, suggesting critiques of current policy, and endeavouring to, I don't know, revive New Deal thinking in a way.
It's an effort to say, take Paul Krugman. During the bank crisis, the public had learned to hate the banks. They were ready to see anything done. Rather than letting them conceal their bad debts, you could do what they did in other countries, which is say, open your books. We're going to run the banks briefly, at least, until you're on your feet again. And you could also say to them, as a price for refloating you out of the public treasury, we're going to take over all the bad mortgages and turn them into state housing. Now, this is what a democratic socialist would do, and where the vision in America is totally lacking. You could have got away with that. You could have had a huge stock of state housing, which for the first time gave the bottom third of Americans homes. You could have had the scheme you had in New Zealand. If you pay a bit extra, you'll get to own it. I mean, the way to not have subprime mortgages devastating the economy is to abolish them in favor of state housing. Why should poor people be expected to finance their own homes? It always means, this is what I meant in the book. I mean, a social democratic perspective is almost entirely lacking. And of course, as you know, three chapters are how America's in denial on the race issue.
Yeah, the one that you know, struck me most was the Lost Boys. This is a chapter about, well, there are a lot of people, some of them leaders in the black American community, who sort of have a moralistic critique of the sort of sexual behavior of black women. Say, well, you know, why are all these children being born out of wedlock? You know, why, you actually quote someone as saying, you know, why lie down with every fool?
Well, that's what Obama said.
Yeah. And, well, it's Obama. And, your answer to this is that this sort of moralistic critique ignores the sort of structure of the situation. Assume, let's just assume that you're a black woman, that you're a reasonably rational person, and that you have, in particular, one objective. You have many other objectives, but this is one that's important to you. You would like, at some stage in your life, to have and raise children.
Yeah.
And and obviously, it's much better if you can do this with the help of a sort of decent, respectable man, you know.
Someone who's viable.
Someone who's viable, someone who is most of the time in work, someone who can be a sort of help to you. That's obviously the best way to do it.
Well, you have to look at it through a market analysis. I found that for every 100 black women of marriageable age, there are only 57 black men who either hadn't married white women, and the ones who marry white women are usually very successful. So that drains the pool. Of course, white men won't marry black women, so they're restricted to the remainder, and the rest are either dead in jail or missing. As many as 10% are people that even the census or the army can't locate. So the immorality of black women is equivalent to censuring Russian women after World War II, when there were only about 70 men for every 100 women. You could get up on your high horse and say, 30% of this generation will never have children. You crucify black women with that every generation. If they didn't have children out of wedlock, 43% of all black women would be childless, which of course is insane. So you have to modify morality in the light of a market analysis of the situation. And this shows, of course, how economics and politics and morality interweave.
That's right. And this is the application of basic market thinking to a situation. We assume these people are rational actors, and we point out the choices that they face.
Well, we know they are. We know as many black women aspire to a stable family as white. That has been established. We know that as many of them at least look forward to a stable partner. That raises the question, what happens when these are in short supply? And of course, the situation becomes vicious. If black males know that they can get sex without marriage, they're much more likely to withhold marriage. It creates a seller's market. So you have a whole range of factors that interrelate.
Yeah, and there's a huge number of black men in jail. There's a staggering number who are dead. There's the other thing you mentioned.
They're the lost boys.
The ones who simply are bureaucratically invisible. The state can't see them. They're not dead, because when people die, you generally find their corpse. So they're alive, but wherever they are, they're not likely to be, good partners to be married to. They're just invisible to the state.
There are a million black men in America today for whom we have birth certificates and no death certificates.
Right. We're coming quite then. There are several things we could still talk about, but just to close, say a bit more about your projected book on climate change. What's that going to be
about? I think two sorts of people are in denial. The people who deny climate change, of course, and the people who think that you can tame our industrial growth sufficiently to solve the problem, who really think Kyoto could work. When in point of fact, in order to stop putting carbon in the air, you would probably have to have reverse growth. And no political leader can put up with that.
Right, and so that is the key problem.
Yeah, they're both in denial. And the only real solution is some type of benign climate engineering which has the least ill effect, that gives us a generation of keeping temperature down until we get really clean fuel. That's it in a nutshell.
Right. And I think on that point, we can conclude. So thank you very much, Jim. It's been very interesting talking to you.
No, I've very much enjoyed it.